Peace and blessings, beautiful souls. I am Brandi L. Bates, and you are now listening to Power Podcasts. You can find me on Twitter at Soledad Francis, and on Instagram at Brandi is Winnie. You can find most of these podcasts archived on YouTube. And of course, please do subscribe on YouTube. Follow us on SoundCloud, hashtag Power Podcasts, and subscribe on Podomatic, Brandi Bates, Podomatic.com, hashtag Power Podcasts. Attention is the key, folks. For where man's attention goes, there goes his energy, and he himself can only follow. We're going to get into some real deep esoteric shit today for that ass. Today I'm talking about gondola wish. Gondola wish. And how the brain is a transmitter and receiver of frequency. Stay with me. I have a lot of ground to cover and a short time to get there. So I'm going to try my very best to keep you mesmerized and fascinated and learning and growing and empowered. Understand that the mind is so powerful, and I think sometimes we lose sight of how powerful our minds are. Like, seriously, everything you want, anything you want to do, anything and everything you want to achieve or have or do or be or accomplish or see, can be had through the power of the imagination and the power of the mind. And this is a fact. The brain, the mind, is a transmitter and receiver of frequency and vibration. It passes through the ether, through solid objects. It travels faster than the speed of light, and there is a magnetic pull and an electrical pull. Stay with me, okay? It's a your mind is a universal transmitter, just like a radio, old school radio, AM, FM, and the difference is it's tuned into all vibrational frequencies at one time. So when you are listening to the radio, an old school, not Spotify, not Pandora, not internet radio, old school radio where you have to turn a dial and tune into certain frequencies or radio stations, as it were, to listen to what you wanted to listen to. So whether you want to listen to AM radio, talk radio, right? Or you want to listen to hip hop, you want to listen to jazz, you want to listen to classical, you want to listen to opera, you want to listen to pop, rock, 80s, old school, oldies but goodies, so forth and so on. You have to tune into the station that you want to listen to. The thing about the mind as a universal transmitter of vibrational frequency is that it can tune into everything all at once. So basically, everything that you see, everything that you hear, taste, touch, smell, and feel is all being absorbed into your mind at once. So that's why, you know, they say, you know, don't operate your cell phone while you're driving, because it's no different than essentially driving drunk. Because basically, the minute you pay attention to that text message, or you're looking on your Instagram, or you're looking on your Facebook while you're driving, and you're looking at your phone, your device, your attention is going to that particular vibrational frequency. And in that snap second, you can miss someone pulling in front of you or someone instantly jamming on the brakes, so forth and so on. That's just an example. But the point of it is, you are constantly, your mind is absorbing billions, billions, billions of smells, of scents, of sound, of odor, of thought, of things you're seeing, subliminal shit that you are seeing, but you see it. Your conscious mind is not paying attention to it, but your subconscious mind is picking up on all that shit. You guys don't even know it, but the Pepsi logo has all types of built-in subliminal messaging in it. It always has. I'll get on that later. It might be for another podcast, but even in the news, there are subliminal messages built into the program. So while you're listening to radio or television, you're driving down the street, you're walking down the street, there are so many signals and so much noise. I'll just call it noise. Shit you're hearing, seeing, your subconscious mind is picking up on shit, your memories and past lives, all of this is going into your subconscious mind, okay? And these are all affecting the vibrational frequencies that you're picking up, okay? Stay with me. Lot of ground. All right. Do you realize, this is 2017, do you realize they are now weaponizing everything from marijuana to mosquitoes to weather and biological pathogens? The U.S. is being targeted with remote viewing and has been, this has been done by Russia for years, years. And so the Soviets have been tapping our telephones and other forms of communication. How do you think they were able to efficiently sway public opinion of the world superpower of our elections? Okay? I'm gonna tell you how real this shit is. Okay? Research Project Stargate. Project Stargate. Stay with me. The project and its precursors and sister projects, this is all CIA, okay, Central Intelligence Agency, as you know it now, it's Facebook. I hope y'all know Facebook is CIA. That's why I don't have my ass on it, but that's, again, another podcast, another day. But it went by various code names, Stargate, and this is where we get Gondola Wish, okay? One of the projects was Project Gondola Wish. Another project was Project Grill Flame, Project Center Lane, Project Sunstreak, Project Scannate. And so up until I think it was 1991 when they were consolidated and they were rechristened as the Stargate Project, okay? Now the Stargate Project, the work behind it was primarily involved with remote viewing, okay? And this was the purported ability to psychically see events, to see sites such as the pyramids of Giza, or, you know, the Kremlin, or the White House, or information from a great distance, okay? Now understand, parallel to the non-classified program, okay, Project Stargate is a highly advanced, deep black remote viewing program that still remains active to this day, okay? That's not even touching on the technology that they're getting from hyperdimensional beings. Again, another podcast, another day. Today we're talking about Gondola Wish. We're talking about remote viewing, and I'm gonna bring it down to a level where you can understand how to make this shit work for you, okay? And make it really, really, really work for you, okay? So your brain is a transmitter and receiver of frequency and vibration. We've got that out of the way. Understand, it's just a fact. This is science, The government knows this. Scientists know this. Nikola Tesla told us this. Elon Musk knows this. Bill Gates knows this. Okay? It's like that of a radio. And it sends signals. Your thoughts are signals throughout the universe, throughout the world. And it receives signals. You can receive other people's thoughts or signals, right? And we know this because that's why you can think about someone and then all of a sudden, like you're thinking about your ex, right? And all of a sudden, they text or email you or call you, right? And you'll be like, damn, I was just thinking about you. But you don't say that, right? But that's an idea, an example of you tapping into the ability to control those signals, okay? Thought frequency is vibrations or telepathy. And it's about using your mind as a radio transmitter receiver, like a satellite cell phone. Okay? Using your mind as a cell phone tower. Okay? Stay with me. It's using your intuitive receiver. Okay? The side of your mind. You can tap into the cosmic computer, okay? There's a cosmic computer, meaning the universe, some call it God, some call it universal intelligence, some call it the subconscious realm. He talks about it in the three magic words. They talk about it in the law of attraction and the secret. But basically, it's like the ether. And this is where we get all creative ideas. This is where the imagination taps into to get ideas and to get and to receive thoughts and to put shit out there. Put your thoughts and your signals out there, right? Stay with me, please. Please, I promise you. We're going somewhere. So in fact, you do this all the time. And you might need practice in learning how to turn off your logical mind. Because a lot of times, your logical mind will psych you out and be like, this some bullshit. You know, this that spooky shit. This that new age shit. But in fact, it's real. It's your intuition. And you've been using it. Your ancestors have been using it. Some people call it magic, M-A-G-I-C-K. Some people call it law of attraction. Some people call it the God force. I've talked about that before, your God force. But today we're talking about how do we learn how to use this to work for us. Life is difficult enough. We need some breaks. We need some tips and tricks and help overall, right? All right, so how, for instance, how you believe others view you only reveals what you think about yourself. Equally so, how others perceive you merely suggests the depth to which they know themselves. All my Christians, in scripture, we're told that God made man in his own image. It's so stated not only in the Bible, but also in the holy writings of nearly all enlightened people. The Bhagavad Gita, the Quran. The Jewish patriarchs taught that the human body was the microcosm or little cosmos, right? We talk about the cosmos, the universe, made in the image of the macrocosm or the great cosmos. There is no doubt that the Old Testament is a psychological and anatomical textbook to those capable of reading it from a scientific viewpoint. Now I'm going to make it relevant to you. So understand the functions of the human body, the attributes of the human mind, the qualities of the human soul have been personified by the wise men from the ancient world, and a great drama has been built around their relationships to themselves and to each other. That's what scripture is. Everything in scripture is talking about humankind the mind, and the human body. All of it. When you think about the zodiac, and you think about the notion of the 12 houses of the zodiac, or the 12 tribes of Shabazz, the 12 tribes of Jacob, they're talking about functions of the human body, as above, so below. The great Hermetic axiom that which is above is like unto that which is below, and that which is below is like unto that which is above. That's what they're talking about. Stay with me. Hold on, I'm telling you, we're going somewhere. Okay, so remember those times in your life where everything just seemed to work out? Might have been when you were 16 years old, when you were 21 years old, when you were 10, whatever, right? Everything was popping. Your mindset was lean, undistracted, pristinely focused on the vital few pursuits that most fueled your fire, right? Whatever the shit you were into. Your heart set was dialed in so that everything you did was performed with joy and wonder and zero remorse over the past. You're not thinking about your ex. You're not thinking about your mama. You're not thinking about your daddy. You're not thinking about, you know, all the bullshit that you think about now. Your health set was calibrated so your energy was strong and your stamina was superb, right? You were clicking on all cylinders. Think back. And your soul set was at peak, so you felt you were living for a mission that was so much bigger than yourself. Because the best times in your life are when you are doing work that is bigger than you. Writing a book that is going to affect hundreds, thousands, possibly millions. Your life was overflowing with meaning. You might have been pouring into your children. You might have been pouring into your career, pouring into your company, pouring into your passion, right? I'm saying all this to say you can learn how to do this. You can be trained on how to use your mind to do mental martial art. It's trainable and reproducible. Mental martial art. In the Hebrew Bible of the Old Testament and in the New Testament, the Holy of Holies, Kodesh HaKodashim, that's what they call it in Hebrew, Kodesh HaKodashim, the Holy of Holies, sits behind the two pillars and refers to the inner sanctuary of the tabernacle where God was believed to be present. Okay? Stay with me. It's further described as an inner shrine housing the Ark of the Covenant, guarded by two winged golden cherubim, and an outer chamber or a holy place with a golden lampstand and a table for showbread, and you have your altar of incense, etc., etc., etc. Okay, same thing we see today in most Catholic churches, or just, you know, most churches, to be honest. Okay, the meaning of tabernacle in Hebrew, Mishkan, is a dwelling place or to take up temporary residence, especially to inhabit a physical body. Now, this allegorical description, of the Holy of Holies as an inner shrine and a temporary residence to inhabit a physical body tells us esoterically where this tabernacle is located. It's a dwelling place or to take up temporary residence to inhabit a physical body. What does this mean? It's not only a man-made building or structure, but also part of the human body. And that in science, we can simply call the tabernacle our skull, which holds the chalice for our brains, with the winged golden cherubim guarding our thoughts, being our hippocampus, or Amon's horn. Amon's horn. Okay? Stay with me. The Stargate Project created a set of protocols designed to make the research of clairvoyance and out-of-body experiences more scientific. That's what they were trying to do. They were trying to make the idea and the concept of psychic ability, clairvoyance, less spooky, less new agey, less weird, right? When in reality, this is the shit that runs the show, okay? When you see in the tarot deck, where are my brujas, right? The image of the magician. He's always got one arm pointed up and one pointed down. And that indicates as above, so below. Okay? We see that with the Baphomet. One arm pointed up, one arm pointed down. As above, so below. When you see images of the so-called quote-unquote Christ with one hand pointed up or the little two fingers pointed up, right? And then the other down on his chest. Right? As above, so below. That's what they're trying to tell you. It's encoded in the art. Hello? Okay. And so the atoms and molecules of the book are recordings of the consciousness level of the author. This is why it's so crucial to read shit. Not on some blogging, not on some, podcasts are wonderful. And I appreciate you. Everybody who's listening to this. But you got to get your head in the books. Less Facebook, more face in a book. Because the atoms and molecules of a book are recordings of the consciousness level of the author. And they're locked at that author's thought frequency. And the vibrations that the atoms broadcast are what you tune into. And every atom is a vortex of energy locked in a regular pattern that repeats due to being stuck at a fixed frequency. And so every atom is a radio crystal. When you get in, like, when you get temporarily unstuck, it becomes irregular. And until it solidifies again, you can exert some influence over which frequency it will get stuck at by the thought frequency that you dwell in, that you keep your mind's transmitter / receiver set on. So especially when you're going through like peak experience in your life, peak good, peak bad, peak low, peak high, you should use magnetic recording media to help you collect your thoughts until you get all of your goals and your issues into perspective. Okay, that's why we have this podcast. It's one thing to read the book, another thing to hear it. When I was younger, I would say, probably about 10 years ago, 10 to 12 years ago, I started recording my goals. I would, and I talk about writing out your 101 goals of places you want to go, people you want to see, things you want to do, what do you want to accomplish, what do you want to have, who do you want to become, what would you like to achieve, right? Write it out, but also record it. And I don't talk a lot about this because it's just kind of something I did for myself. And I would record my goals. I wrote them out. I write them out all the time. I have my vision board, but I would record my goals and listen to them at night before I go to bed. And I'd listen to them in the morning when I'm still kind of in a sleep state, sleepy, dreamy, kind of, woozy. And also a lot of times just listen to them like while stuck in traffic. About 10, 12 years ago, I started doing this. And I'll be damned if a lot of that shit did not come to pass, has not come to pass. It has come to pass. Most of it that I've talked about. I literally wrote out and recorded the countries that I wanted to visit, and in the order that I wrote them down and recorded them, that's the order that I visited those countries. I kid you not. I'm not. I swear to you. I wouldn't lie to you. That's how real this is. We're talking about the mind as a transmitter receiver. Okay? And tapping into your psychic abilities. tapping into your clairvoyance to make shit happen for you. Okay. Here's a powerful idea. Understand that the key to longevity in business is originality. And so those caught up in the 95%, you know, are all competing with each other. 95% of the population, 95% of the people at your job, 95% of the population, 95% of the entrepreneurs are all competing with each other. They're all suffering from the brutal trap of the commoditization of their products and services and hurting from inevitable price drops that come with that race to the bottom. That's why you can always see McDonald's will say, oh, we're offering 2-for-1 burgers for $5. And then Burger King will say, well, we're offering two Whoppers for $3. Right? And then Wendy's will say, hey, we're offering 20 chicken McNuggets or chicken nuggets for $2. They're all competing for a race to the bottom. That's why nobody can fuck with Walmart, Wally World. Nobody can fuck with them because their prices are so low. One thing I will say I learned from Sam Walton, founder and CEO of Walmart, is to always keep your eye on your competition. He'd go into his competitor stores and look at their prices, look at what they were selling, look at the quality of the products, look and study it. This is what he did. And to this day, this is why they are one of the greatest and the wealthiest businesses in the world, globally. Okay, so that aside, just put that out there for my business owners, my entrepreneurs, my big ballers. But business builders in the top 5% run a very, very different race. Very different race. We talking, we're talking rare air. Okay. Rather than competing, they are creating. We're talking Usain Bolt level. Rather than copying, they are making. Rather than following, they are leading. And as a result, these rare air professionals receive dramatically more in income, more in applause, more in opportunity. And so, bringing it back to the mind and, you know, the science of self, every time someone's leftover lower self finds a reason to manifest, the lower self, right? Your anger issues, your ego issues, the need to get revenge, the jealousy. This is the essence of the lower self. Every time someone's leftover lower self finds a reason to manifest, someone else is going to have to remind them of the larger purpose to help them to re-enable their higher self and relate to the problem in a manner that ensures that we all survive. Everything we do all day, every day is recording our tomorrows. Okay, understand. That's why I do this. Okay, I'm here to help you to re-enable your higher self, higher minded thoughts, higher minded loftier goals and concepts and signals. Everything we do is recording our tomorrows, your thoughts, your words, your actions, your intention. And so this movie is projected by the thoughts we have today, and the movie only runs forward. And so if we can get enough people to join with us in thinking kind thoughts about that tomorrow today, when we wake up in that tomorrow, it will be a kinder world. It's that simple. Okay? It really is that simple. That's why you see the shit that you see on YouTube, or you see and hear what you hear on TV. And we are in a fallen world. And even the education is dumbing down the kids. The kids aren't getting smarter, they're getting dumber. even though they're incarnating onto this planet with abilities far beyond what we, you know, incarnated into this world with, and our parents and their parents and their parents, they're coming here with greater psychic abilities and greater intuitive abilities. But the schooling and the government and the systems, right, are like handcuffs, and it's making us dumber in a sense. But all we are doing is to take the entire thought force and all those tuned into it into another universe. That's what the Mandela effect is about. That's what happened in 2012, okay? Universe defined as one of the intermingled movie or dreams that we are all existing in. Because I'm in your movie, baby, and you in my movie. You're in my dream and I'm in your dream. And this is the same, ironically, watch this. This is the same symbolically as what Christians look for in the rapture. The rapture has been going on, and it always goes on. Old, worn out universes die off and new universes are born at every second of time. And we can carry whatever we want into the next world. That's the takeaway lesson from the movie Apocalypto. I remember one of my close friends, she said to me, and it made perfect sense, and ever since then I've carried this with me. When people die, think about Rwanda, right? Think about Rwanda, the Tutsis, and all the hundreds of thousands of people who lost their lives in Zaire, right? And for them, it was the end of the world. It was their apocalypse. When the Mayans died off, it was the end of their world. It was their apocalypse. For you, when you die, when you transition from this earth realm, it will be the end of the world. It will be the end of your world here, your existence on this plane, this dimension. It is your apocalypse. And so that's happening all the time. And so that's why I have to remind people, when you read or hear about the end of the world, we're all going to experience the end of the world. That's our death and transition. No, don't fear it. You know, take away the fear. Take away the fear. Take away the, you know, fire and brimstone and burning in hell, all this shit. But it's the end of your world. It's the end of your experience in this space-time on this dimension. And we all will experience that. And that's why that is happening all the time. And as people are leaving and transitioning or dying, it's the end of their world. It's collectively the end of a lot of worlds. And so if some of the people want to live and go on living in the old worn out universes, it may work for a while, but eventually the old games don't work and the old customs don't work. Pretending and conniving and conning and cheating don't work anymore because intent is sensed telepathically. Intent is not fooled by words. That's why you can say, you know, I have these positive affirmations. I'm rich. I am healthy. I am powerful. I am love. You know, I am wealthy. I am powerful. I am love. God is good. Life is good. And that's wonderful. But telepathically, inside, if you feel like shit and you're not feeling it and you're not with it, mentally and psychologically and spiritually, your soul is like, you full of shit. You full of shit. You're not rich. You're not wealthy. You're not healthy. You're not happy. You broke. You powerless. And you're depressed. And so you continue to manifest that. Because you can't fool the soul. And so the old reality dissolves and the new reality solidifies. And the dreamed for or dreamed up world of peace and harmony becomes real. Right out here in front of us, the God force works through us, is working through us. Go back and listen to my podcast on the God force. Please, 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 please. And so our society collectively, our collective consciousness. I'm talking to you whether you are in North America, South America, Central America, Africa, Europe, Asia, Eurasia. Collectively, our collective consciousness is the cumulative effect of all our individual and family realities on the reality level of one person or one household or one community is lower. For whatever reason, our whole collective reality is lower. And I've said it before, everything is connected to everything else. You could think, oh, well, you know, whatever happens to them, fuck them, it's about us. But no. Everything that's happening to them is affecting you. And everything that's happening to you is affecting the whole. And so instead of doing what everyone else is doing, my loving suggestion is that you go blue ocean. Go blue ocean, baby. Go blue ocean. Venture out into the foreign territory of service, of products, of art that the world has never seen. Feel that massive void. And then make your services so breathtakingly great that no one can resist them. Make your art so breathtakingly great that this world cannot ignore you. To leap to legendary and utterly dominate whatever it is that you're doing, you need to absolutely disrupt the status quo and the way things have always been done. Think Harry Potter, Airbnb, Amazon, Netflix, Uber, Miles Davis, Coltrane, Red Bull, Warren Buffett. And so release the result and love the process. The best athletes, the best artists, entrepreneurs, change generators all learn to understand that the quality of your practice sets up the caliber of your performance. And so detaching from the ultimate end goal, we're talking about practice? Practice. We're talking about practice. Practice. We're talking about practice. The quality of your practice sets up the caliber of your performance. And detaching from the ultimate end goal frees up your passion and talent for mastery of daily training. This is whether you're an athlete, an artist, an entrepreneur, a parent, a business owner, a teacher, a professor, an accountant, customer service rep. Manage the downdraft of your upper level. Manage the downdraft of your upper level. Stay with me. What I mean by this is that every gift that makes you special in one area carries with it a weakness in another area. So for instance, wildly creative people birth game-changing ideas, yet they often struggle with structure. They struggle with schedules. They struggle with order. They're like, you fucking up my flow. Right? How many of y'all dated a writer or a photographer, right? You gotta be careful you fuck up they flow, right? But cultural heroes are often so invested in improving the world that they have zero time for their families. They don't got time for church. They don't got time for your bar mitzvah. They don't got time to go to your shit, right? Because they doing what they do. And so to stay in the pocket of your own original greatness, grow the awareness to manage the downside of the strengths you've been blessed with. Because a lot of times, your blessings are both your blessing and your curse. And when you grow up, you'll understand what I'm talking about. In the Bible, the word for skull is called Golgotha. Golgotha. Which is Latin for place of the skull. Okay, think about Indiana Jones, Golgotha. And this is the exact location where the Christ was crucified on the cross, or logos. And that's where the blood of the Christ fell onto Adam's skull. And that restored Adam back to life. This is another allegorical story, okay? Stay with me. This is an allegorical story about the secret gnosis that occurs alchemically through our brains, our minds, and especially within our hippocampus, which has been proven in science controls our memories. We know that the hippocampus controls our memories. And I believe it also pertains to past life memories as well. Okay, but the story also relates to our blood with that of the Christ that fell onto Adam's skull. Stay with me. So the ancients and many philosophers have known that the blood is our mind where we obtain our conscience and also the seat of our soul. And it's been said that whoever controls the blood controls the mind. Whoever controls the blood controls the mind. Because the blood is the mind. Just like the semen is the spirit. The semen is the spirit. Same thing as our spinal fluid. And the blood is the mind. So it's these esoteric teachings that have been encoded into biblical stories, Quran, Bhagavad Gita, that many people fail to recognize. It's written and inscribed on the walls, the hieroglyphs of the pyramids. Esoteric teachings. But in that are codes. And people don't understand. I'm hipping you the game, okay? Outproduce your peers. Do you hear me? Outproduce your peers. This is not about working. This is about leaving your mark. This is about telling future generations you were here in a real way, in the flesh. What are you producing? Nobody is going to remember who worked in the cubicle downstairs or on the fourth floor. For General Electric. But all my writers, my poets, my artists, my philosophers, what are you producing? In the brain of man, between the wings of the kneeling cherubim, is the mercy seat. And there man speaks with his God, as the priest of the tabernacle spoke to the Spirit of the Lord, hovering between the wings of the angels. What am I talking about? Man is the ark. You are the ark. And within you are the three principles, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the tablets of the law, the pot of manna, the rod that budded. But as in the case of the ancient Israelites in Hebrew, when they became crystallized, the pot of manna and the rod that budded were removed from the ark. And all that was left were the tablets, or the letters of the law, the logos, the word. And so I say that to say, you are the temple. Apply the 1% win concept. You are the temple. What made Google, Uber, Nike, Amazon legendary was not one giant move that galvanized their greatness on a sunny Monday or Tuesday morning, but a series of tiny iterations done daily. What are your habits looking like? Because you got to get consistent in your habits. How you're thinking, the signals you are transmitting and receiving, and what you're doing. And so extraordinary businesses are much more evolution than revolution. Small, daily, seemingly insignificant improvements lead to staggering results over time. And this applies to human performance too. Thank you for listening, folks. I appreciate you for rocking with me. Thank you for supporting us. Go out and have a wonderful magnificent, amazing, blessed rest of your day. Like I always say, call your folks, call your mom, call your dad, call your kids. Reach out and touch somebody and tell them you love them, because life is short and we are not promised tomorrow. Peace and blessings. Talk to you next week.